Bloomberg Audio Studios.
Podcasts, radio, news.
You're listening to Bloomberg UK Politics. I'm Stephen Carroll.
And I'm James Woolcock. So, Stephen, I come in very early into work, and mm-hmm. I often worry that this is increasingly becoming slightly too much of my identity. But I do notice that it's getting increasingly dark outside.
Oh, James, it's mid-August.
I know, and I'm the early one, so I'm the canary in the coal mine here. But I even saw a colleague wearing a proper jacket, and so you know what that means. It is turning, the seasons are going, and someone who I think is going to be quite concerned about the sunlight fading is Chancellor Rachel Reeves. Now, we know that autumn is going to be a very difficult time for this new Labour government. You have a civil servant spending review, and that's coupled with the budget and likely tax increases. And we can already see some of those difficult decisions in her announcement that the winter fuel allowance will, from this year, be means tested. It's caused a lot of controversy. Recently, a petition to keep the measure by Charity Age UK has surpassed 400,000 signatures. And on top of that, a new survey shows that a quarter of UK residents are considering turning off their heating due to fears about rising bills this winter, when the energy cap price is going to be unleashed this Friday. So all of this is going to spell quite a difficult picture for the new government, as it has promised to lower energy costs and help the country's most vulnerable.
Yeah, it certainly seems to be a bit of a string of bad news and warnings that things are going to be less optimistic, more gloomy perhaps, after the rush of optimism that we've had since the election as well. Because of course the price cap announcement, the expectation from one researcher from Cornwall are saying that they're expecting to go up by some 9% this Friday, which of course will come into force from October. So that's something to watch out for as well. But there's a question too about, I suppose, how you politically talk about these difficult decisions. Could Labour have been more upfront before the election about some of the difficult decisions they were going to have to make? You could argue that they said it often enough that it was going to be difficult. We had that, of course, press conference from Rachel Reeves, and they talked about the fiscal black hole that they'd found in the finances as well. So the questions are, is how important or how politically astute is it to make decisions like that around the winter fuel allowance? It's clearly going to cause some people quite a lot of pain. There's going to be about 10 million fewer people entitled to that fuel allowance this year as a result of it becoming means tested. But then there's the question of, do you get the bad news out of the way first when you've been elected? Think back to 2010 and the VAT hike under George Osborne. Is that something that voters really remembered when they went to the polls the next time after that? Well, let's get the view of someone who's very well versed in Labour strategy, John McTernan. John McTernan served as political secretary to Tony Blair and advisor to the Labour Party. He's now a senior advisor at the communications firm BCW. John, great to have you with us on the programme. Is this the case that Labour told us things were going to be difficult, the decisions are coming now, and we're sort of just getting an idea, I suppose, of how difficult the situation is?
Well, I think you knew how difficult it was going to be because the Tory government held an early election. If they thought there was any headroom in the budget available, they'd have had a September fiscal event, probably another cut in national insurance, an attempt to make tax cuts versus a tax increase in the dividing line of an election. So I think both parties knew it was going to be hard. The Tories did their best to kick things down the road so that they had to crystallise under whoever was the next government. And I think that's what the intention of Rachel's early statement on the state of the budget was, to frame this up as we've had a terrible inheritance. And yes, that is, you know, it's an attempt to do the same thing that George Osborne did with attacking the Labour government consistently, blaming the Labour government for the global financial crisis. And the key about the global financial crisis is it was global. It wasn't made in Downing Street. It was made on Wall Street.
I think, though, in hindsight, now we're sort of out of the blitz of the election campaign, do you think the Labour administration, well, the shadow administration as it was then, tied themselves too tightly in their campaign promises?
Oh, look, I think they should probably stuck much more rigidly to the line that Tony Blair and Gordon Brown had in 1997, the election campaign then, when Labour basically said, we'll not raise the basic rate of income tax, which left a great deal more of flexibility. And Labour were forced by a weak Tory government who didn't move in the polls, really, from October 2022, when Rishi took over, to the election day. So a dying Tory government was unable to shift the needle at all in anything they did. But Labour got too scared, I think. So if you rule out any changes on any level of income tax, of any of the bands, you rule out any changes on VAT level or coverage, and you rule out anything on national insurance. You rule out a huge amount of revenue, just simply reversing the national insurance cuts that were pushed through by the Tories to try to buy votes but failed to buy votes, would give Labour a lot more spending power. And I think that was understandable caution because Labour had lost four elections in a row. But if you rule out all of those taxes, which are basically on individual workers, you end up with only two areas to tax, which is pensions and property. And I don't think they are going to be any easier to tax than any of the other areas. So Labour has got itself into a difficulty on tax and spend, trying to answer the Tory accusation, which is that Labour will always spend more and will always increase taxes. The problem being the country voted for change and vote for more of the same.
I'd argue that characterization you just gave is kind of one of an unforced political error. I guess to a lot of our listeners, people in business, finance, senior in the civil service, they'll be wondering if they are tied in too tightly for any kind of easy solution. So they're going to have to make some portions of the population suffer. And at the moment, like you say, it's pensioners, it might also be property holders, we'll see. What are the core missions of this government? Who is going to suffer the least? Who is going to be prioritised if, like you say, we are going to have to renege on some of these promises?
Well, I don't think promises are being reneged on. I think the unarguable core of and the non-negotiable core of the Labour manifesto, the Labour missions, the government's missions, is to create a fairer country. Fairness is at the heart of all that Labour stands for, what Labour governments do. And that's really the core of the change on the winter fuel allowance, is it's no longer fair to give that money to every pensioner. That money should be targeted. I think that is a good argument and a good way of understanding it, because this year's uprating of the state pension is larger than the winter fuel allowance. Next year's uprating of the state pension will be larger than the winter fuel allowance. For 14 years, there's been the triple lock, which links pensions to, quite often gets linked to earnings, which gives a big uplift. Labour's committed to the triple lock for the next 5 years, the term of the government. That means nearly 20 years of the triple lock. The winter fuel allowance is an old allowance. It was brought in when pensions were only linked to prices, and there was one year, wasn't there, when the pension only went up by 75p. So you can see there's a fairness argument lurking in what Labour's done. I don't think it's been pushed hard enough or made hard enough. If Labour were clearer that actually what's driving what they're doing is not balancing the books, but what's driving it is an aim for growth and an aim for greater fairness, that would be stronger ground to stand on.
But fairness can be subjective as well, from certain people's point of view. And certainly, while you lay out the maths of it very clearly, it's very difficult to shake off the idea of pensioners switching off their heat because they say they can't afford it or they feel they can't afford it. How does a new Labour government with the wind in its sails try to push back against that pretty stark image?
Well, the fact is that pension credit has increased as well as the state pension. State pension was in 2010, it was around £100, £97, £100. It's now around £220. There's been really big increases that have come through correctly and rightly to pensioners. The issue that it was underplayed, I think, and is probably the weakness in the argument is, of the 2.3, 2.4 million pensioners who could claim pension credit and therefore bring the poorest pensioners to be brought higher up, and the pensioners are going to be targeted with winter fuel allowance. Over a third of them don't pay pension credit, and so the balancing policy with targeting has to be to use local government, use government, national government data, use machine learning and AI to identify who are these 800, 900,000 pensioners who are entitled to pension credit and don't claim it. There's kind of a lack of sophistication in a way, which is that we know the money should be targeted, we know the targeting of the benefit pension credit that's meant to be the vehicle to get the mid-fuel earners people, and we know that's not reaching over a third of the people who should be receiving that support. And I think that's the kind of thing. If fairness and tackling inequality is the core of the Labour missions, because it's right there at the heart of all the missions, the five missions, then it needs to be there in the delivery of the hard decisions as well. Because the hard decisions, in terms of Labour pressure inside the movement, inside the parliamentary party, even inside the cabinet, is to end the two-child limit support for children. That's because the two-child limit is putting kids into poverty. And that has to be something that a Labour government stops doing. So this test, fairness, may well be something that's contestable, but unfairness is objectively clear, and it's clear in lots of areas in the country. It's clear in the lack of access to council housing. It's clear in the impact of rents on individuals. It's clear in the impact of house prices. And so there's a sense in which Labour's not arguing strongly for its mandate. It's a mandate for change. It's a mandate for the missions. It's a mandate for tackling inequality and bringing greater fairness through the system, whether it's social care or whether it's access to social housing.
See, John, this is why it's so good to have you on, because I would argue that you just there have very eloquently painted a much clearer picture than some Labour politicians of what they want to do. I think, like you've already noted, and polls have said, people voted to be rid of the Conservatives, and in many ways, Labour haven't defined this mission as clearly as you have. So I think, like you say, you look at social care, you look at immigration, obviously a big issue at the moment, local government finance, the number of crises looming. Is there a risk that because Labour haven't defined themselves in the election campaign, they are now going to be defined by their tough choices in office?
The danger is to end up seeming like technocrats, not politicians. Because the country didn't vote for better management of a conservative approach to the United Kingdom. They voted for change, change of management, and change of direction. And it's clear the country understands it took 14 years to destroy the economy. It took 14 years to destroy public services. It will not be reversible in 14 days. And the Labour government, one of the interesting things is they've only been in power for 6 weeks, 7 weeks, hardly been in office for a minute. And so the way to get people to buy into a project of change is to be clear. And Keir was during the election campaign, but there's been less of this in government. Renewal is what's required. And a decade of renewal means making slow but steady and irreversible progress. And I think that sense of the political narrative that colours in the missions, the political narrative that sits around all the actions, a political narrative that explains why the hard choices are. It cannot be that a Labour government, a Labour cabinet, a Labour chancellor, a Labour prime minister stands up and says, we'd like to do this, we don't have the money. That's not the ideology of a social democratic party. It's the ideology of an accountant.
John, thank you very much for your time and insights in the programme today. John McTernan served as political secretary to Tony Blair, now senior advisor at the communications firm BCW. That's it from us for today. If you like the programme, don't forget to subscribe and give it 5 stars so other people can find it on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you listen.
This episode was produced by Tiwa Adebayo and Sophie Arundel, and our audio engineer was Peter Nicolino. I'm James Woolcock.
And I'm Stephen Carroll. We'll be back with more tomorrow. This is Bloomberg.